Hey everyone, Professor Dave again. I want to tell you some things about free radical chemistry.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
So we are used to electrons as existing in pairs, either within a covalent bond or as a lone pair. But electrons can also be unpaired, and these would be called free radicals. So let's learn a little bit about free radicals. If we're looking at a carbon radical, this system is sp2 hybridized and therefore trigonal planar. So it's a lot like a carbocation here. This carbon is missing a fourth electron domain, which is why it is sp2 hybridized and trigonal planar. But here, this carbon is actually neutral because it is contributing four electrons to this Lewis dot structure. It's just that one of them is unpaired. And so the carbon radical is sitting in this unhybridized p orbital. So it is sp2 hybridized overall and planar. So that's very important to understand the geometry of these things. And then a little bit about the stability. Very similar again to carbocations. The more substituted a carbon radical is, the more stable it is, because a carbon radical, even though it is neutral, is a form of electron deficiency. So a carbon radical trend is going to very closely follow carbocation stability trend. So the least stable would be the methyl, just as the methyl carbocation would be very unstable. And then as this becomes more substituted, it becomes more stable because of the hyperconjugation that is occurring from neighboring alkyl groups, just the same way neighboring alkyl groups would stabilize a carbocation. And then the most stable is this allylic. Just as with the carbocation, we can have resonance here. So that is a stabilizing factor. So these are some things that we need to know about all radicals. Now let's take a look at how radicals form. So up until now, when we've seen electrons rearranging, we're used to seeing heterolytic bond cleavage. So this is something like, let's say, a leaving group leaving a molecule. So the pair of electrons would leave with one of the atoms, and we'd have a cation and an anion. That's heterolysis, right? That is a pair of electrons moving. But we can also have homolytic bond cleavage. That would be a case where the two electrons in the covalent bond, one would stay with one atom, and then the other would stay with the other atom. Sort of the reversal of the formation of a covalent bond. And so that would leave us with radicals. And there are certain things that can promote homolysis. So we would wonder, why aren't we seeing this? What is it that would promote this? Well, as it happens, there are certain kinds of covalent bonds, for example, oxygen-oxygen covalent bonds and halogen-halogen covalent bonds, that If that bond is heated or struck with a photon of very specific energy, usually UV light, that will actually promote homolysis because it will excite one of the electrons from the lowest or from the highest occupied molecular orbital to the lowest unoccupied molecular orbital, which in this case would be the sigma antibonding orbital. So if we have a covalent bond where two electrons are sitting in the bonding orbital, those atoms will remain bound. But if because one of the electrons in this bond is struck by, let's say, a photon of UV light and is promoted to the antibonding orbital, then we'll have one in bonding, one in antibonding, then the bond order will be zero. And that is what promotes homolysis and this kind of situation. So those are the key, that's basically what's promoting free radical reactions, is when we have homolysis of these oxygen-oxygen bonds, halogen-halogen bonds. There are some other possibilities there. But now that we understand that, we want to look at the three steps that are involved in any radical reaction. And so they have names and there are characteristics about them that will be true no matter which radical reaction we are looking at. So every radical reaction has an initiation step. So an initiation step is the homolysis step. This is where a covalent compound becomes two radicals. So we have one covalent compound, and then this will become two radicals. Now, one thing that we need to understand is that up until now we've been using double-headed electron pushing arrows. Now we must use single-headed electron pushing arrows, because a double-headed electron pushing arrow denotes the movement of a pair of electrons. Now that we are talking about the movement of singular electrons, we must use single-headed arrows to describe exactly that. So here we have a single electron from this covalent bond staying with A and a single electron staying with B, generating our two radical species. Now, every initiation reaction is going to be endothermic. It is going to be enthalpically unfavorable because some energy must be absorbed by this system, be it heat energy or the energy from the photon of UV light or whatever is happening. This system must absorb energy for homolytic bond cleavage to occur. So initiation will always be endothermic. Once we have radical species, we will have one or more propagation steps. Now, there could be many propagation steps. There could be one propagation step. It depends on exactly which reaction mechanism we are looking at. But there will always be propagation steps. And that is a situation where one radical species and one covalent species generates a different radical species and a different covalent species. So this is basically, we're looking at A, the radical. So this electron and one electron from this covalent bond are going to now form the covalent bond between A and B. The other electron in this covalent bond is staying with C to generate the other radical species. So propagation, once again, one radical species, one covalent species, generating a different radical and a different covalent species. Now, in terms of enthalpy, you cannot predict offhand whether a propagation step will be endothermic or exothermic because it depends on the bond energies involved. So you could go to a table of thermodynamic data and calculate yourself what the energy is stored in this bond versus the bond that you're generating, and then you could go ahead and calculate the delta H of that reaction. But a propagation step is not inherently endothermic or exothermic. Then lastly, there's going to be a termination step, typically, or at least that's what radicals can do. And so this is a situation where two radicals go to form a single covalent species. So here we can see the electron that is the radical from each species going together to form this covalent bond. This is essentially the reversal of the initiation step, although it need not be the two species that generated the radicals in the initiation step. Basically, any two radicals, be they halogen, alkyl, or what have you, if they generate a covalent bond between them, that would be considered a termination step. Now, just as initiation will always be endothermic, termination will always be exothermic because we have these very high energy, unstable radical species that would be very high on an energy diagram, then going to form a covalent bond between them, which is a storage of energy. Any bond is a storage of energy. So that will bring this whole system to a much lower energy. So initiation always endothermic, termination always exothermic. Propagation depends on which bonds are breaking and forming. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. And as always, feel free to email me with questions, professordaveexplains@gmail.com.